Bloodhound Books presents Mother Said So by Jocelyn Dexter. Narrated by Mark Peachey. Chapter 1. Rosie's Ma. Augusta Dalton sat and brushed her hair in front of the mirror. She was waiting for that nice girl to come and help her get washed and dressed. What was her name again? She should know it. She saw her every day and looked forward to seeing her. What was her name? Beatrice? Brenda? Barbara? Something that began with a B, Augusta was sure. There was a knock on the door. Augusta watched her face in the mirror and saw it break into a smile. It must be the bee woman. But it wasn't. It was that strange woman who she didn't know at all. The woman who often came and talked nonsense to her. Hello, Ma. It's me, Rosie. How are you?
Very well, thank you.
This was always horribly awkward. Augusta didn't like to be rude. But who was this woman? She recognized her only because she remembered the repetitive conversations they always had. The plea from the woman she didn't know that Augusta must remember her. How can I remember her? I don't know who she is, and yet she insists I do know her. It's me, Ma. Your daughter. Remember? Look, I found some more photographs of us together. Have a look at them. Maybe you'll remember something. Augusta politely took the pictures and looked at them. Didn't know what she was looking for. And anyway, she didn't have a daughter. She'd never had a child, be it male or female. She would have remembered. She wasn't mad. But she pretended to look anyway, screwing up her eyes and holding the photographs at arm's length. Her eyesight was getting worse and worse. Soon she'd have to stand at the opposite side of the room to read the newspaper. She didn't know why she bothered reading the silly thing anyway. It was filled with news that she didn't understand about people she didn't know doing things she couldn't quite get to grips with. See, Ma? That's you and me at the beach when I was 11. Do you remember how I hated that swimming costume? But you made me wear it. Told me how lovely I looked in it. I didn't like the colour, but you said the blue matched the colour of my eyes. Sky blue, you said. Remember? Beautiful sky blue. Augusta was getting cross. I don't know what you're talking about, whoever you are. You can't be here when the bee woman gets here. She'll be here any minute, and I have to get washed and dressed. I'm not ready for visitors, not in my dressing gown. Go away. Immediately, Augusta felt she'd been rude and horrid. She put her hand on the stranger's arm. My, how old and wrinkled my skin has become, and softened her tone. I'm sorry, but I think it best if you leave now. Perhaps you could come another time. Please don't come again. You get me all confused and upset. I don't know who you are. It was as if Augusta hadn't spoken. The girl gripped her hand and squeezed it. Please, Ma, please remember me. How can you have forgotten me? The girl smiled and held her arms out high and wide to the sides of her body. I'm your favourite and only child. You adore me, and I adore you. I'm sorry I haven't visited for a bit, but I've been busy. Go away, please go away. I'm waiting for my wash and need help getting dressed. I can help you with that. You most certainly cannot. You're a stranger. I don't know who you are. How many times do I have to say it? Please, please go away and leave me alone. Go away and don't come back. I'm sorry, but I don't know you. I don't have a daughter. Augusta tried a smile. It's time for you to leave now, or I'll scream. Augusta watched as the young woman left the room. Her shoulders slumped. Something like sadness touched Augusta, but she shook it off. Must be indigestion after that apple crumble. Where is Bee? I do wish she'd come. I do so like her. She's easy to be with, and I know who she is, even if I do always forget her name. Bee is my friend, not like that stranger who won't leave me alone. Augusta turned back to the mirror and again was surprised at how old she had become. There was a knock on the door, and in walked B.
"Morning, Augusta. How are you this morning? Was that your daughter I saw leaving?"
"What are you talking about, Bernadette? I don't have a daughter. I've never had one. Please, can I have my bath now?"
Chapter 2. Dennis. 6 months ago. Dennis wasn't having a great birthday. He looked down at his present from Mother, which lay in his lap. Picking it up, he ran it through his hands, raised his eyes to Mother. Mother, whom he always thought of with a capital M. M as if she were an object. A horrid and spiteful thing from which he couldn't escape. Until now. At that moment, a moment of real clarity, the cruel birthday gift galvanized him. Right there and then, he decided to run away. Escape. From her, from here, to somewhere new. He had never forgiven her for calling him Dennis. Dennis Quince. Dennis was up there with Trevor and Norman, or Clive. Names for weird, sad men. Mother used his name against him. Neither spoke as he touched the malicious present resting in his hands, but her eyes glinted with an amusement filled with poison.
"Thank you, Mother. It's just what I've always wanted."
She split her lips into a vicious gash of a smile, as if a wound had opened up in her face.
"I knew it would be."
Dad averted his gaze, pretending that he wasn't there, that this wasn't happening. Dennis wanted to hit him. His father's ineptitude, his ineffectualness, his total acceptance of everything that Mother did overwhelmed Dennis with an unexpected fury. He realized just how very weak and feeble Dad really was. For the first time, he felt himself despising him. "Why am I still living here?" Dennis had always known he was a washed-out, beaten-down, false start of a person. Insipid, vapid, and useless, because of Mother. But now, realizing that he could simply up and leave, he knew this was potentially his time to light up his corner of the world. Clutching his present, wanting to strangle it, and so desperately wanting to shine, he knew that he'd start off only flickering instead of full-on glowing, until he got used to it. And then, people would notice he was alive. He promised himself that he'd ignore the inevitable lack of self-belief that would threaten to overwhelm him once he got going, and told himself he could do this. Inside, keeping his face a blank and his suddenly and hastily formulated escape plan hidden, more of a vague outline at this point, he smiled, in cahoots with himself. Something as simple as Mother's malice, wrapped as it was in spangly paper with an oversized red bow, was enough to highlight his ridiculous existence in this house. He shouldn't have to put up with this abuse. It was abuse. But until now, he'd never acknowledged it as such. He'd joined in the game and played alongside Dad, who went along with everything, pathetically accepting. But no more. He was going to move out, get a social life, and most importantly, get a girlfriend. His ultimate goal was to achieve an identity for himself that didn't quake in his boots and hide away, inadequate and frightened of the world. Dennis wanted to be a man about town. He would cut those apron strings that had bound him for as long as he could remember to the thing that was Mother. That would show her. His father was probably too diluted by life and wouldn't notice the emerging new Dennis until the metamorphosis was complete. That didn't matter. Dennis's target was Mother. He was taken aback, sitting there in his chair, to all appearances as normal and as unchanged as ever, that this radical change could bloom into a serious and now concrete plan so effortlessly. Perhaps it had always been there, festering quietly, waiting for release. Ready or not, here I come. Chapter 3. Dennis. now. Go on, go. Dennis's father made a shooing motion with his hands. It's about bloody time, he smiled. And I'm proud of you, son, but I know you'll understand if I leave you to it. I'll just clutter up the place. He shrugged, as if it were a worn-out, useless gesture. The last shrug in his repertoire. You'll be better off on your own anyway. If you need me, I'll be in the garden. Just tell her straight out. You can do it. He patted Dennis on the shoulder, gave it a little squeeze of reassurance. And well done. I'll always be here for you. You do know that, don't you? I'm not good for much, but I'm good for that. Dennis smiled politely at his father, aware that Dad was doing brave from a distance. Not in the same room as Mother, he could afford to cheer on Dennis from the sidelines. Remote courage coming to the fore. Pointless. They did an awkward back-patting thing, both knowing it was too late to be any more physically tactile at this stage in their relationship. They were both emotionally stunted, rendered far too inhibited to kiss each other on the cheek. Dennis knew that he and his father suffered from a frailty of personality. The two of them were lacking in any real substance. But over the last 6 months, Dennis had grown in stature and belief. He had the beginnings of a life now. Outside of this house and away from both Mother and Dad, it had remained his secret. Until now. His insides curdled. He wasn't sure if it was anticipation, anxiety, or excitement. The woman who dominated his and Dad's lives had successfully and systematically ground them down with her vitriol, airbrushing them into tremulous shadows of the people they otherwise might have been. He told himself it was normal that he still reacted to her as he did. He and Dad nodded briskly at each other before going their separate ways, both pretending that neither were struggling. But I am stronger than Dad. I know that now. I've proved it. Dennis was now a regular at his local pub, a fixture. Admittedly, he hadn't spoken to anyone yet, but was on nodding terms with a few. Not very many women turned up, certainly none who was single, so no women-related sweating problems had occurred. He'd achieved the makings of friends at least. The beginnings of friends, anyway. Some people actually recognized him and nodded vaguely in his direction. He also had a real home of his own. He was on a roll. Dennis found Mother sitting in the kitchen. He realized he was trembling and felt childlike for doing so, sucking in air as if it might make the words come out more fluently once expelled. He said, I'll be moving out at the end of the month, Mother. He was unable to hide the pride as it covered his face. He imagined a great big glow of boast bouncing right off him. Just saying the words out loud made him feel more of a man. Drawing the line at actually beaming at her, because he didn't want to bring on one of her tirades against him, Dennis happily settled for a smug expression instead, confident that it would annoy. He tried not to delight in Mother's surprise as her jaw hung momentarily before she arranged her lips into a moo of distaste and derision. But he definitely shocked her, and that pleased him. Putting those unhelpful thoughts aside, he allowed himself to stand tall with his newfound sense of achievement. He challenged her with his statement, and he was most resolutely not backing down. I can do this. I can escape Mother. I can be me, Dennis Quince, urban playboy. Don't be stupid, Dennis. You can't leave. This is your home. It's where you belong. You must stay. You have to. I don't have to do anything that I don't choose to. I'm all grown up now, Mother. It's time. He thought his tone allowed for no further discussion. Assertion and command of the conversation dictated that he'd won this particular round. Easily. Perhaps he should have challenged her long ago. Mother got up and came to stand directly in front of him. The smell of lavender wafted over him from her pinched and powdered face, combined with a hint of stale nicotine. She made a mocking, derisory snorting sound.
So go. I don't care. You think my world will stop spinning? It won't. But I'll tell you one thing, Dennis Quince. You will not stop having dinner with me. At 6:30, every evening. That is the rule in this house. Whether you go or whether you stay, you will obey it. You owe me that, if nothing else.
Obediently, he nodded, aware that he'd lost ground by doing so. But it was the rule. It was his punishment, and he had no choice but to pay the price. Ignoring this weakness, refusing to allow it to detract from his important announcement, he concentrated instead on his decision to finally flee the nest. Of course it was time he moved out of his parents' house. He was 33. Dennis hoped it wasn't too late. So, this time, spurred on by what he hoped was not a fleeting belief in himself, but instead a more permanent hope that possessed him, Dennis did not drop his gaze from Mother as she glared at him in unspoken fury, her face twisted with her dislike of him. He swept back his blonde curly hair.
Your gorgeous golden ringlets,
Mother called them, in her softer, madder moments, when she was deeply engrossed in her obsessive fantasy and readjusted the elastic band that held it in a ponytail.
Okay, Mother. I agree to those terms. I'll still have dinner with you every night, but I shan't be staying. I won't be living here. Not anymore.
He smiled at her, prepared to show willing, conceded a little ground. She glared back at him, and the smile died on his lips, as if it had never been. He wasn't confrontational by nature, because he tried to be a good son, and it was easier not fighting. He was trying to stand on his own 2 feet. If that actively provoked Mother, what could he do? She certainly seemed provoked, and he took more than a little pleasure in that. Inside, he smiled and scrunched up his toes inside his work boots, thrilled by his own audacity. Of course, he knew he'd always been such a disappointment to her. She wasn't quiet on the subject.
You're such an underachiever, Dennis. You never do anything. You've always been so dull. Why don't you get a proper job? Why haven't you got a girlfriend? You still haven't got a girlfriend. What are you waiting for? What is wrong with you? You're no better than your father, just as weak.
And so it had gone on, forever, a never-ending litany of things at which he'd failed and continued to fail. But things were about to change, had already started to change. Dennis was now determined to battle on with his own existence, trying to achieve something. Anything would do. Anything at all, really. He'd left Dad behind. Only Dennis could change the course of his life, and moving out was his second step. First step had been finding and maintaining a social life in the pub. Achieved. Getting a girlfriend was third on his list of must-dos, and he would be victorious in that too. Keeping his hands in his pocket, his middle finger worried at the skin around his thumb. Pick, pick, pick. He stopped himself from actually taking his hand out and biting at his cuticle. It would only further irritate Mother. But, he reminded himself, I will finally be free of her. I've done it. I'm moving out. I am free of her. Except for dinner, at 6:30 every evening. That he couldn't escape. Not yet.
Chapter 4. Mother.
Charlotte Quince had watched Dennis leave the house, the last of his books and possessions hastily parceled and packaged neatly into his car, his steps quick, his furtive glances back at the house swift but craven, hurrying, 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 as if he couldn't wait to be gone. But she was pleased to note that he was unable to hide his guilt. It was written all over his face. That gave her some small satisfaction. With her nose pressed to the window pane, the breath from her open mouth misted the glass. She drew back her head and sketched a smiley face in the condensation with her finger. Nasty Dennis was gone. He'd certainly taken his time in leaving the family home. She'd often wondered if he'd been waiting for her to actually physically eject him, to throw him out, baggage and all. Of course, she never had, and probably never would have, because she'd enjoyed having him on hand to torment him. Despite her dislike for her son, he had at least provided daily entertainment whilst he'd been under her roof. But he was so weak and ineffectual. It amazed her that she'd ended up with two such inadequate men. Although the term men was rather a grandiose word for the two male members who she'd lived with for over 35 years. Now she was left with only the one male person. If she was being honest with herself, it was frankly one man too many. But she could never be bothered to actually do anything about her marital appendage. Henry was simply there, like a disused and uncared for thing. She barely noticed his existence anymore and found it frighteningly easy to ignore him. Henry, the doctor who'd run away from the reality of their marital disharmony, had pretended the horror of Dennis's birth hadn't happened and had taken a professional move sideways. From being a GP, her husband had escaped into his new role of helping women, family planning, his special interest. It had been like a slap in the face. What a fool he was. His escape from the monstrous event that was their son, leaving her to deal with real life on her own, was beyond selfish. Dennis, her responsibility, her crusade, her husband's avoidance. Because her child would still be coming, as promised, as was quite right and proper, to dine with her every evening. That was enough. She easily buried all thoughts of Henry, buried them deep. Perhaps this way was better. This way, with Dennis not actually living there, meant she had her 6:30 appointment to look forward to. And how much greater her anticipation would be without the ghastly Dennis underfoot the entire time, distracting her, irritating her, getting in the way. On the occasions when her son was out of the house working, she'd go about her daily routine, happily cleaning and dusting, changing sheets, putting the clothes in the washing machine, making the house absolutely spotless. She liked clean. The cleaner and sharper the better. Much like life. And she never missed her daily walk. That was an important time which she cherished, and nothing would make her miss that particular ritual. She enjoyed watching others go about their day and wishing that she wasn't simply an observer, but more of a participant. The walk was her reminder that she wasn't who she wanted to be, and never had been. Strangely, it made Charlotte feel superior. In the early evening, at 5:30 sharp, she'd rustle up and serve a simple supper and pretend to share it with her simple husband, Henry. She'd push the food around the plate with her fork, going through the motions. This farcical ritual had been played out by her and her spouse for 23 years. At first, there had been protestations from Henry, but those had diminished in strength over the years, his voice eventually failing him completely. Now, he sat and silently went through the daily early evening charade, not even trying to stop it. Her plate was never touched, the food left uneaten. For what would be the point? She had a real dinner engagement every night. At 6:30, on the dot. She loved it. It was her perfect time. It made her feel truly alive, like a real mother. As was her God-given right. She'd sit on her own from 6:00, always eagerly early, in the small sitting room, dressed properly and appropriately for the occasion, glancing at the clock, ready for her life to be filled, waiting, waiting, waiting. Chapter 5. Rosie.
Hello, my name's Rosie, and I'm an alcoholic.
A round of applause greeted my words, followed by a chorus of a collectively earnest,
Hello, Rosie.
the group in perfect harmony and synchronicity. I considered curtsying and giving a small speech, mentioning everyone who loved me. Didn't think it would go down too well, though. Best to play the game, as hard as I found it. My toes curled with the insincerity of it all. I coughed, my mouth dry, and wished I had a drink. A large gin, whiskey, or even vodka. Not fussy. Ice not a necessity. At this moment in time, I'd accept anything that even smelt alcoholic. Instead, I politely took a sip from my bottle of water. All eyes looked at me. I was acutely aware they wanted me to tell all. A frank story of my wasted life, ruined by drink. My throat screamed out for alcoholic lubrication. Courage and all that. A sly shot of whiskey would give me the bravery to speak, instead of staring into the abyss of a total and very dry mutism. Wrong attitude. I assumed my story had been heard a million times before, but still, I had to say something. Anything. Hello. Right. I laughed and cringed inside and adjusted my whiskey-coloured top. If I couldn't drink the stuff, I'd sure as hell wear the colours, like a badge, for bad behaviour. Or maybe it was merely a token of remembrance, like a discoloured whiskey-sodden poppy. As I said, I'm an alcoholic, but I held up my index finger to ward off the cheers that would surely come following this announcement. But I haven't had a drink for 5 months. More applause, rapturous, as if I'd trilled out a marvellous love song, instead of words that were not worthy of much more than a deep sympathy. Pity, even, though they were true words, and it hadn't been easy. After several half-hearted attempts to slowly cut down my alcohol intake and getting nowhere near even remotely dry, I decided instead to simply stop drinking. Just like that. I hadn't felt like doing cartwheels, but I'd got through it. And here I was. Woohoo! Not a drink in 5 months. Give that girl 10 out of 10 stars. God. It was all so stupidly and ridiculously pathetic. I wanted to spew. I wanted to shout. I wanted a drink. And I don't even feel like drinking, I lied, and shook my head for emphasis. Not even a little bit. This didn't go down as well as my opening lines. Instantly, I'd lost the adoration of my audience. Doubt had crept onto the faces as they studied me. The now very skeptical faces. Heads angled sideways, as if tuning in to the lie in my words. All of their expressions now showed only outright disbelief. It washed over me, the recipient of a mass, undisguised incredulity which verged on the bloody offensive. Derisive, mocking, sarcastic smiles. I wished I wasn't here. Am I that transparent in my lie? I'd had a drink 2 weeks ago, and it had been like bloody nectar. Obviously, I hadn't stopped at one glass of wine. Had finished the bottle and why the hell not? Had drunk another bottle. Had a few shots, because it was there. Because I was there. We were natural partners. It was an obsessive relationship. Like an unhappy marriage that you stupidly refused to give up on, even though it was destroying you. But that 2 week ago drink had been my only slip, and that would remain my secret. No, really, I don't feel like a drink. Whether you believe me or not, it doesn't matter. Anyway, in a nutshell, I rolled my eyes internally, hating the fact that I needed to do this. I've ruined my life by drinking. Lost everything and everyone. Successful job, nice home, all gone. I clicked my fingers. Just like that. A life 1 minute, next, nothing. And all because I drank. It's destroyed me and left me with nothing. The end. They probably wanted more. But that had been an honest assessment, a précis of my life to date, and at this point, I wasn't willing to add in any emotion to my tale. It was nobody's business but mine. I'd been coming here for days and days, every night for a month, bar my one drunken mishap, but had never before spoken. This was, therefore, progress, and I felt that my performance tonight was more than enough. I'd done better than I'd anticipated. It had relieved my building tension, the mounting stress of not talking. Naturally, after my outpouring of honesty, I felt like celebrating. That thought instantly translated into images of partying, which automatically made my mind skitter over the vision of a glass of vodka on the rocks, the condensation dripping down the glass, the lemon wedged up tight against the ice cubes. Stop it! Telling myself to concentrate on my mini victory in this anonymous room, I deleted the vivid, too vivid, picture in my mind. Told myself, there, it is done. My humiliation had been hung out to dry like clothes pegged on a line waiting for the wind. I patted myself on the back with politely disguised triumph, relieved that I'd told the heart of my personal story, and accepted, with head bowed, the thanks and clapping that full-stopped my tale. Leaving quickly, I walked away with an almost swagger. I felt great. Wanted to show off to someone, to tell more people that I wasn't drinking anymore. But I had no one in particular to tell. The elation which had initially propelled me along the street wore off pretty bloody quickly. Like the warm, slow burn of a shot, it all too quickly turned to nothing. That was why drinking was so easy. You started, and then you carried on, and you carried on feeling marvelous. Until you didn't. And just what had I achieved tonight? I told a bunch of total strangers that I was an alcoholic. Hardly cause for a celebration. Irritation with my life quickly became anger. That was all I'd gained this evening, a burning resentment. My joy had been a tease, fleeting, flirting, leaving me wanting another blast of it, wanting it to be a permanent thing. I'd wanted to hug it to me forever. Turned out there were no legs in joy. With no one else to tell, my declaration of my new teetotal life, my short-lived victory, had become so insipid, it was barely recognizable as a positive thing. Now it felt like nothing. Diluted. Watered down. I preferred my highs neat. By the time I came upon the little pub on the corner, 30 minutes had passed. Dawdling, I'd been in no hurry to get back to my crappy little bedsit. What would I do there? Checking my canvas bag, I made sure I had cigarettes, mobile, money. I had everything I needed on me. Hot to trot. Try stopping me. Forget the trot. I gathered speed and did a jaunty little canter, an almost gallop down the road, the anticipation almost hurting. With only yards to go, I imagined I could already smell the alcohol. All I could think of was having a drink, and I knew from past experience, once I'd thought it, gave it elbow room in my head, it was as good as done. Decision already made, I pushed through the swing doors. One little drink wouldn't hurt. What was the worst that could happen? Chapter 6. Dennis. It was 3 o'clock in the morning, and because he'd always had problems sleeping, Dennis was on one of his nocturnal motorized meanderings. Killing time. Killing the night. Desperate for the daylight, when he could try harder to succeed. If nothing else, he was determined in the attainment of his third and most important goal in life. To be loved. By a real woman. There was always a sense of excitement, prowling in his car in the darkness. It made him feel like he was doing something. He wasn't sure exactly what, but something. Ludicrously, Dennis felt naughty on his nightly insomniac drives. Drumming his fingers on the steering wheel, he allowed himself to delight in thoughts of his new house. It wasn't typical accommodation for a man of his age. The arrangement might be interpreted as slightly more conducive to the life of a student or perhaps a much older man grateful for any roof under which he could temporarily rest his bones, but it suited him. He'd answered an advertisement online, had been interviewed by a couple with two young children, had given references from his various employers, had agreed to a criminal check, more than happy to oblige. Anything that would hasten the process. So desperate to escape mother, he'd have agreed to anything. He was quick to run, with arms outstretched, into his new home. Had to stop himself from breaking into a full-on sprint. The Green family and Dennis had signed a contract, and he was now the lodger in the basement of an empty for 6 months family home. Dennis had moved in 1 month ago. He paid a nominal fee, and in return, whilst the Greens, Mr., Mrs., and their two baby Greens, were working and living abroad, he acted as caretaker for the property. Opened and shut curtains, turned lights on and off in the main house, ditto the heating, dependent upon the weather, of course. A little light dusting, a quick vacuum. He kept the house running and in good order. And he never failed to lock up the premises, safe and sound. He had no inclination to wander around the Green's house as if it were his own. It wasn't. But the basement was his. And much to his delight, the main sitting room housed a piano, and he couldn't resist playing it. Apart from that, he happily preferred and stuck to his own personal quarters in the bowels of the house. He only entered the Green space, other than for cleaning purposes, for access to his own little room, use of the kitchen, and to carry out his very simple but carefully scheduled household tasks. Mother, thankfully, had shown no desire to see his new home, and he knew she certainly wouldn't approve of the basement, would think it too haphazard and uncouth an arrangement. She wouldn't ever approve of anything he did. He drove sedately along the road, keeping to the speed limit and giving his self-pity full rein. He allowed his thoughts to travel along well-trodden and familiar ground. However hard he tried, and however painful it was, he conceded that Mother might have a point about him being fairly bloody useless. He was acutely aware that he was very dull. Dennis epitomized any man you might see on the street. Instantly forgettable. He'd long ago given up even trying to pretend that he was exciting. He wasn't. He was someone who wouldn't be missed by anyone for any reason. Certainly not by Mother. Or perhaps only by Mother. He could never quite work that one out. It was no surprise to either himself or to anyone that he was single. He gave himself 0 out of 10 for remarkability. Because of his very ordinary personality, it was unlikely that anyone ever noticed him at all. Faces failed to light up when he spoke. There was no discernible disappointment when he stopped speaking. He sighed and changed gear. It would help if he had a girlfriend. But he'd never done well with the ladies. Small talk was impossible. He couldn't even do teeny-tiny talk with the opposite sex. Big, serious talk was out of the question. Actual, real, face-to-face talking to women made him stammer and bluster. Even the thought of talking to women made him sweat. Not a little damp perspiration that could be concealed, but instead a serious and disgusting fear sweat drench that had an anticipatory stench of rejection to it. It would pool in puddles under his armpits and on his upper lip, and he could smell himself. He'd seen girls actually wrinkle their noses at his body odor and not so discreetly turn their heads. It was such a feeble and horribly visual display of his own lack of self-confidence that he loathed it. If there was only one thing that he could rid himself of, it would be this. The sweat accentuated and exhibited his weakness, so it made it too easy for women to see and laugh at him. He'd got to the point that he actually feared sweat, and that, of course, compounded the problem. However, Dennis still had hope that there was a Miss Wright out there, waiting for him. Maybe he'd find her in the pub one night. He might find her anywhere. Anywhere would do. That optimism hadn't died. Not yet, anyway. He reminded himself what he'd accomplished so far. Patted himself on the back. Felt a little better. but he didn't want to be lonely anymore. He was determined to get himself a woman, sweat or not. Lost in thought, driving aimlessly around, going nowhere in particular, he caught sight of something in his peripheral vision. Something yellowish, caught fleetingly in his headlights as he'd passed. At first he'd thought it was litter, perhaps a pile of clothes or rags lying in the gutter. Tonight the air was oppressive, clingy, sweaty. Sweaty for anyone. He'd wound down his window at the start of his journey, and so had a very clear picture of the crumpled pile of material at the side of the road as he pulled up a few meters beyond it. But it wasn't just litter. It was a litter of lady. Slowing to a stop, Dennis put the handbrake on, turned off the engine, wanted a better look, tried to peer across the passenger seat and out of the window. Impossible. Finally, he undid his seatbelt and, opening his door, got out. Standing over the still form of a young woman, he sucked his breath in through puckered, silently whistling lips. She was perhaps in her late 20s, 30 at a push. Her face was bruised and cut, her clothes disheveled. The mustardy yellow colored shirt she wore barely covered her chest, with only two buttons done up. Wrongly. One naked breast was exposed. He averted his eyes, not wanting to delight in her nudity. He wasn't that type of man. She was barefoot. Seeing the woman was breathing gave Dennis some calm. Her chest moved slowly but regularly, up and down. Her face was simply beautiful. He had to guess at her height as she lay on her back, not too tall, not too short, not too fat, not too thin. Completely delicious. Oh, so perfect. She was also unconscious. Quickly going back to the car, he took a grey blanket from the trunk and hurried back to the girl. Bending his knees, he swiftly wrapped her body tenderly in the grey wool and scooped her up as if she were a wondrous offering. With some difficulty, he opened the passenger door and laid the woman in the seat, careful to put her safety belt on. Made sure that the strap covered her naked breast. Her body weight sagged towards the gear stick, and he pulled her back, positioning her head against the passenger side door. There. Much more comfy. Of course, he knew that he should immediately take her to the hospital, but he couldn't get over his luck. What were the chances? She was like a gift from the gods. It was like she'd been lying there, waiting especially for him to come along. Running around the car, he looked up and around, checking that no one was watching him. As things stood, he had done nothing wrong at this point, but still, he was relieved that his nocturnal find was just between him and the woman. I'm the good Samaritan here. His skin goose-pimpled, as if a cold chill had fluttered over his body, as he realized what he could do. Here was a woman, in his car, totally reliant on him. It was a situation he wasn't familiar with, but he instantly felt excitement, a naughtiness, the outright potential badness that sung quietly in the cloyingly thick air. His mouth dry, he pulled her body forward, feeling beholden to put her mind at rest by speaking kindly to her, not wanting to frighten her. He said quietly, "Excuse me, I have to check you don't have a mobile on you. Don't fret, I'm not going to hurt you." He was worried that she'd suddenly awake and get the wrong impression and make a hasty and unnecessary phone call. There was no response from her, and he found nothing in her pockets. Surprisingly, she still had a bag slung over her shoulder. No phone in there, nothing. No money, no identification. Totally empty. Dennis assumed she must have been attacked, mugged, had her purse and mobile stolen. Folding up the bag neatly, he heard and felt the scrunch of paper. Reopening the bag, he whispered his hands quickly through the canvas, saw a zip on the inside and opened it. There was an envelope, its flap unsealed. Shaking out the contents, Dennis found himself looking at a photograph of a young woman and a child. Turning the picture over, someone had written, "Me and Ma, Summer 2000. Shrugging, He inspected the handwritten addressed envelope and put it in his back pocket. Maybe it would prove to be important. Maybe not. His search of her had been a painless experience for both, and not a blush nor a stammer from him, and no sweating. I've impressed myself, he thought happily and unexpectedly, even when he'd spoken directly to her. Driving slowly away, he kept his eyes in his rearview mirror, still waiting for someone to stop him. But no one did. As he took a bend in the road, away from where he'd found his prize, he let out a sigh of relief. At the end of the street, he reached a junction and put the handbrake on again, ever vigilant of the highway code. Sitting, hands on wheel, breathing calmly, he considered his options. Left to the hospital, right to his basement. Without overthinking it, he turned right. Dennis had a feeling everything would be all right. He'd look after her. Without his intervention, God only knew what might have happened to her. He persuaded himself that he'd actually saved her life. And, as everyone knew, if you saved a person's life, you were forever responsible for them. It was a responsibility he looked forward to. His very own adult commitment. With a woman. As easy as that. It all felt perfectly orchestrated and right. Chapter 7. Dennis. Out of nowhere, Dennis's heart seemed to have come to life, and he delighted in the feel of it, the very visceral thump-thump of it as it beat in his chest. The basement beckoned. He hurried, foot pressed on the accelerator, overexcited that his little space was getting its very first guest. Constantly checking that she was still breathing, Dennis decided that despite the obvious, although not serious, wounds to her body, the woman was in fact passed out dead to the world, drunk. It wasn't anything he'd personally experienced. He only politely supped at his pint in the pub, maybe 2 pints if he was feeling daring. Never more than that. He was too sensible for such madness. But he was relieved that her chest still visibly moved up and down, and was more than a little amused that she'd started to snore. Not being a doctor, he couldn't categorically say that it wasn't a medical emergency, but he rather suspected he was correct in his diagnosis. An unconscious drunk. No more than that. She was definitely lucky he'd come along. Slowing down as he approached his home, Dennis checked the mirror, as he always did at this stage of the journey. He was always afraid that Mother might miraculously find him by choosing to follow him one night, on a spiteful whim. He wouldn't put it past her. She was sly like that. It was imperative that she never found out where his very own secret hidey hole was. It was his, not Mother's. She wasn't welcome. But he was more than willing to share it now with this snoring, drunk woman. There was a long drive up to the house, and that added to the feelings of security and privacy for Dennis, the secrecy of the house. In the first 4 weeks of his living here, out of common courtesy, he'd nodded briefly and quickly at neighbors, but they had been, and continued to be, as uninterested in him as he was in them. Because it was the middle of the night, the place was deserted, and he and his new woman arrived safely and soundly at the front door. The lie of the land couldn't have been more ideal for his very first female visitor. He did a little jig of excitement on the grass, knowing that they were totally alone, and he danced only for her. Mother would be surprised at this turn of events, he knew. He wished she could see him now. He smiled as he imagined her look of disdain and disbelief. Believe, Mother, I'm doing something. There was no wind moving the hot summer air, and the quiet was absolute. Getting his young woman out of the car, he carried her through the front door and manhandled, dragged, lifted, steered, and led her down the stairs to the basement, his special place. She mumbled, grunted, but no coherent speech was forthcoming. Wanting her to feel at home, he thought he should redress her in slumberwear, but didn't want to undress her. That would have been unnecessarily intimate at this juncture. An imposition. Instead, ignoring her gaping shirt, he put on a freshly mother-laundered and starched pair of his own pajamas over her clothes and tucked her in under ironed sheets. He wasn't a particular fan of duvets, thought them overrated, and much preferred the weight and comfort of sheets and blankets. He'd bought a set of new bed linen and blankets especially for his underground haven. Lying serenely and fast asleep, his female looked peaceful. At home, he wanted her to be as comfortable as possible when she woke, so he softly cleaned her wounds with a little antiseptic and brushed her hair with his own brush. Gently, gently, frightened to wake her before she got a decent night's sleep. Thankfully, she was still out cold, and not even a peep escaped her pink lips. Pulling up a chair behind the bed, he sat and waited for her to wake up. Lit by a dim but comforting nightlight, he relaxed into his seat, making sure he would be out of her immediate sight when she did wake up. It wouldn't be fair to frighten her. He could appreciate her fear should she wake to a stranger staring at her. Terror was most definitely not what he wanted her to experience on their first meeting. So, he hid quietly in the shadows, skulking. He felt like giggling, but refrained as he knew that he mustn't give in to his overexcited mind. It was also important that he didn't behave like an unruly schoolboy. She deserved his respect. It was 3:30 in the morning. It didn't matter to him how long it took for her to revive. He was more than happy and grateful just to have her in his basement. The addressed envelope and photograph crinkled in his back pocket as he sat on it. He'd say nothing about it. It probably meant nothing anyway. But you just never knew. The hours went by, and he sat in what he thought an amicable and, dare he say, an already familiar silence. Whilst she slept, he quietly brought down some food from the kitchen and transferred it to the basement fridge. Several bottles of water, bread, butter, cheese, and some fruit. There was also some cold chicken for when she recovered her appetite properly. He relaxed in the dim light and waited. As he waited, he was alarmed to find that, as dawn approached, his nerve deserted him. Slowly, but inexorably. Like a leaking tap, so his confidence left him, dripping out of his body, dripping in globules of perspiration. The enormity of what he'd done threatened to overwhelm him. Of course I could talk to her in the car without sweating. She was unconscious. Who am I kidding, being all proud of myself when I spoke to her, showing off that I'd communicated with a woman without perspiring. I wasn't talking to her. I was talking to myself. She couldn't hear. I am truly pathetic. The more he thought about their actual soon-to-be conscious meeting, he started really sweating, started panicking, sweated more. He didn't want her to see him as all other women viewed him, a sweaty, smelly, and physically unpleasant man. Moving swiftly but quietly, he slid open the top of his chest of drawers and selected a jumper. Put it on. A big jumper. A hot jumper. But it would hide his ever-dampening armpits. Slipping out the plastic bag which lined an empty waste paper bin, he put it silently over his already dripping face, tore out holes for his eyes with shaking, moist fingers, ripped out a gash for his mouth. The bag handles drooped down on either side of his face, and he fleetingly considered tying them together, like a bonnet, but realized he'd look ever more ridiculous. What am I doing? It's all going wrong, and it hasn't even started yet. And then he heard her breathing change, and he sat back, a new flood of sweat washing over him. I want to hide, but I'm not going to. I've come this far. I have to do this. He turned on the main light and sat there, wringing his hands, ready to brazen it out. And all he knew was that this was much harder than he'd anticipated. Not having thought it through, he belatedly realized that Mother was probably right. It was no wonder that he had no girlfriend. Dennis hadn't wanted to frighten this woman. but as he saw her slowly come to life, move her arm, sweeping the empty sheets behind her, he knew, with an embarrassed certainty, that he'd not only scare her, but her first view of him, dressed as he was with a white plastic bag over his head, would most definitely terrify her. Suddenly humiliated, he stepped into a small, booked alcove, out of immediate sight of his sleeping beauty. He had only to peep around the wall, and she'd be visible. This wasn't the ideal way to introduce himself on his first date. He wasn't stupid. It could be better. He knew he was losing before he'd even begun. Dennis knew he'd made himself look like a monster. And he wasn't. Truly, he wasn't. Chapter 8. Rosie. I kept my eyes shut, but sleep had deserted me. Lying without moving, I luxuriated in the silence, until I realized how awful I felt. Slam, bam, good morning pain. A familiar awakening, like a punch in the face from an old mate that I wished I didn't know. Groaning, I gently moved my head. The expected headache closed around my entire face like a fist, each imagined finger pressing on my skin, bruising my skin, drilling down into my eyes, making my head throb. The intensity of my post-alcohol agony always surprised me. Normally, at this stage, I'd swallow a couple of diazepam to take the edge off and go back to sleep, but not this morning. As I ran my tongue around my mouth, my senses slowly kicked in. Immediately, I felt I wasn't in my own bedroom. The first clue was the noise of a ticking clock. I didn't have one. The smell of the room wasn't right. The bed wasn't as soft. The air was too stuffy. The bedding was all wrong. Perhaps I'd woken up in someone else's bed. Certainly wouldn't be the first time. Quickly, keeping my eyes shut, I swept the bed behind me with my arm. Empty. Not even warmed by a recently departed man. Although my eyelids were still firmly closed, I realized a light had been turned on. Slowly, I unfurled my eyes, unsure what to expect. It was never good having no memory of how you'd got where you were. I didn't even try to work out how and why and where I was. Just accepted that I shouldn't be here and would now be leaving. Thank you very much. I wasn't frightened by the room. It was just a room, with the main light on, shining bright. It was a nice room, though. I'd certainly woken up in worse places. I saw a fridge, a kettle, and a plain worktop. Curtains, a television built into the wall, and books, lots of books, and a sofa. Swiveling my head to the right, I found the ticking clock on the wall and saw the time. 8:30. Untucking myself from the tightly wrapped sheets and blankets which held me in place, I glanced down at my body. Thankfully, it was clothed with men's pajamas. On further inspection, I discovered I was still wearing my clothes underneath. Bit weird. Gently, I put my hand in between my legs. Didn't feel like I'd had sex. Even better. Things were looking up. Slipping out of the pajamas, I adjusted my clothes and looked around for my bag. Looking for this? Screaming, I spun around to my left and saw my bag hanging from the outstretched arm of an as-yet-unseen body. My voice carried on shrieking, as if I wasn't in control of it. Finally, it stopped, with a pathetic whimper. My breathing came out in little panicked whispers. Choosing not to speak, I waited in silence instead, attempting to keep my gasping panting to a minimum. Slowly, almost reluctantly, the arm was followed by the rest of a man, and I saw his head. Except I didn't. Couldn't. It was covered with a bag. A normal plastic bag, with holes ripped in it. I could only see black beyond the roughly fashioned slashes. There were no features visible. Instinctively, I stepped back and away, wanting distance. Why is he wearing a bag over his head? What's he hiding? Realizing my situation, strange room, very strange stranger with his masked face, I felt the first faint flutter of fear ripple in my stomach. No, I was lying to myself, trying to make it better. It wasn't a ripple. It was more of a violent kick to my guts. I refused to allow it to travel any further. "Hello," the man said. "Welcome to my home." Welcome to my home. What the hell? Breathe. Don't panic. See what's happening first. Think. Don't panic. He held my canvas bag out to me, letting it fall from its long cotton straps, looped around his fingers. His voice was muffled and sounded disembodied. "I think you'll be disappointed. There's nothing in it." I stood back as he shifted his feet, expecting him to approach me. I jumped further back. Seeing my reaction, he held his hands in the air, defensive, showing me he meant no harm. Folding the canvas bag into a neat square, he hung his plastic bagged head as if in shame. It was a strangely forlorn pose. It didn't match the event. I was terrified. Having thrown the empty canvas bag onto the bed, he sat down in a chair and crossed his legs. "What's your name?"
"Rosie."
"Rosie what?"
"Rosie Dalton."
Why did I tell him my full name? It was a stupid extra bit of information that I'd given up too freely. A man with a bag over his head shouldn't be given anything unless absolutely necessary. "I'm Dennis." He leant forward, holding the bag handles round his chin like an old woman intent on keeping the wind from her face. His head clearly tilted downwards, and he spoke to the floor. "I do hope you'll be good, Rosie. When the time comes, I mean. Do you think you will be? Once you've got used to me. Because that would just be great. It would be perfect, in fact." He lifted his head back up, but still all I could see were ripped slits in a bag. His voice sounded like it came with a smile. "Don't look so frightened, Rosie. Everything's going to be fine. Really, there's absolutely no reason for you to be afraid. Sit down. Would you please sit down on the bed? Or perhaps you'd prefer a chair?" He looked around for inspiration. "Or the sofa?" As he stood, I backed away. Felt like I was in the spotlight, highlighted and vulnerable. Would I be good? What sort of question is that? It's a frightening and disturbing one, that's what it is. I'll pretend he didn't say it. "I'd like to go now, Dennis. Thanks for..." What am I thanking him for? Not raping me? Not torturing me? Thanks for not killing me? Thanks for helping me, but I really must go now. Walking backwards, I reached the end of the bed. I paced backwards around the room, keeping the weird Dennis man in sight. Where is the door out? Dennis laughed. It sounded strained and false, as if he were nervous. "Calm down, Rosie. Perhaps you'd like a coffee. And maybe an aspirin. I've got some." His hands disappeared beneath the bag, and it looked like he rubbed his own forehead. He pointed at me. "Don't tell me you haven't got a headache. You were pretty drunk when I found you, I can tell you." He shook the top of his head, as if in wonder, and continued to waggle his finger as if scolding. Gently, he laughed. I realized he was trying to tease, not scold me. He just wasn't very good at it. I felt like his rehearsal for something. He hadn't practiced enough, though, and his performance felt oddly hollow. Listening to him laugh, I allowed my flesh to creep. Couldn't stop it even if I'd wanted. Sweat popped out on my upper lip, and I felt a sudden desire to vomit. Attempting to keep everything as normal as it could be, under the circumstances, I forced a smile to my mouth, swallowed the excess fluid that had squirted inside my cheeks, usually a preface to throwing up. It was as if the insides of my mouth had unexpectedly burst into tears. I forced myself to concentrate on Dennis. The wiry body frame of this Dennis man with a bag over his head was deeply disturbing. It was difficult not to scream and cry and shout and weep, but I didn't. Strangely and instinctively, I knew it would frighten him. And I most definitely needed him on side. So I forced myself not to dwell on the architecture of my dwelling, but instead concentrated on the keeper of the building. I knew it was odd that the man didn't scare me on a physical level. It was because his words, almost jovial and upbeat, and so very normal, were screamingly at odds with his body language. His overall demeanour was demure and apologetic, which he couldn't hide. His stature was puny, his stance unconfident, as if he were embarrassed to be alive. Worn down by life, his shoulders sagged and his head drooped. His physicality was quiet, clearly male, but unthreatening, non-aggressive. But his manner was perky, or pretending to be. The contradiction in his look and his words was horribly offbeat. That was what completely freaked me out. Quickly, I glanced at his hands curled at his side, cut and calloused as if from manual work, but strangely, the actual flesh was lily white. If not for the roughness of his skin, they'd have seemed almost feminine. Long, strong, white fingers. I looked away. Knowing I had to ask the most obvious question, I took a breath. "What's with the bag? On your head?" I added stupidly, as if he needed a reminder. Again his body belted out deflation. "I'm not ready for you to see me yet, but I will be, in time."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.